All right, so first, this is me. My name is Zack Nicklin. I am a UAS instructor at Northland Community and Technical College. I also serve as the co-principal investigator and the director of all things UAS for the National Center of Autonomous Technologies. So anything we do UAS related in some way, shape, or form gets back to me. And that's a great thing because I love what I do. I love working UAS and getting out in the field, working with students, and of course, you know, talking to folks like you. So. A little bit about my background. I got in the UAS field back in 2005 with the U.S. Army. Worked on the RQ-7 Bravo, also known as the Shadow, about a 14-foot wingspan unmanned aircraft. And then I've been working here for about 8 years at Northland College now, with 1 year with our National Science Foundation's AT Center of Excellence, the National Center for Autonomous Technologies. All right, so what is thermography? So basically thermography is writing with heat. So writing or printing with heat. Nowadays we tend not to necessarily write or print, most of it's done digitally, but that's the meaning behind thermography. And thermography has been around for quite some time. We use an infrared imager to produce a thermogram. It's a specific spectrum in the IR spectrum, and we'll get into that a little bit deeper into the slideshow. But they're mainly passive cameras, and essentially every object that is higher in temperature than absolute zero puts out some kind of IR thermal signature. The question is whether or not we have the ability to measure it with the tools that we have, so that way we can see it. But essentially, if we've got, all right, let me grab my, here we go. All right, so we've got any body that we have here. It interacts with IR, specifically the thermal wavelengths, in three different ways. One, it will transmit it, so from the backside to the front side here. Two, it'll absorb it, and three, it'll reflect it. So, in everybody that absorbs it will also emit it to a point, and the efficiency of how well it emits it kind of has to do with the specific makeup of the body itself. So I'll do, went to grab the, there we go. All right, so when we talk about IR and we talk about thermal, we talk about the electromagnetic spectrum. So anything that's radiating anything usually falls into the electromagnetic spectrum here. What we're used to is this very, very small visible spectrum right here in the middle. This is where we see, where our digital cameras see, you know, the images that come up in our computers and our phones, they all fall within that very, very narrow band. If we zoom in a little bit. So now we're a little bit closer and we've kind of zoomed into that IR band that was just to the right of our visible spectrum. So as you can see here, it's actually made up of multiple partial bands. So again, we got the visible spectrum all the way over to your left. And then we've got our near IR, shortwave, midwave, and our long wave. Most of our thermal is done in long wave. So if I know a few folks did some conservation work, some forestry work. We were talking about agriculture the other day. So when we talk about some of the cameras used for agriculture, looking in the IR band, we use that near IR or the red edge very often for a lot of crop studies to understand exactly how those crops are working. Whether or not they're absorbing the light in the way they're supposed to, at the end of the day, whether or not they're healthy. So that's something that most of us are used to. But when we move into the midwave and the long wave IR band, long wave is where most of our thermal is done. Midwave, we do a lot of imaging around something like optical gas detection, which again, I'll show you a little bit later here. Most of the cameras, the thermal cameras that work in the long wave, they're uncooled, right? Which makes them a little bit cheaper than their counterparts that are cooled, but you don't necessarily get as accurate with it. And when we talk about thermal imaging, we talk about generally two distinct types. One, we talk about radiometric and non-radiometric. So our non-radiometric cameras, they will show us images and they will color it based on a heat palette or a color palette, but there's no absolute values in there in the non-radiometric ones. Basically, it's a comparison of the coldest thing and the hottest thing in the picture, in the frame at the time. And then it goes ahead and colors them accordingly, you know, based on that scale. With the radiometric, we've actually got absolute temperatures that we can pull out of it. So we can actually take a temperature of an item and say that it is X degrees, you know, Celsius or Fahrenheit. So as we move into these long wave thermal imagers, we wound up generally working between that 7.5 to 13 micron band. Now this is talking about the wavelength there. And with the mid-range imagers, we really work between the 3.5 to 5 micron band. And the reason behind it is shown right here on this graph. So what this graph is actually showing is what we call an atmospheric window. So at what wavelength does the atmosphere allow us to actually look through it? We all know the atmosphere is made up of multiple different things, and one of those things is water. So we got molecules of water all floating around. What you'll find later on in the slideshow here is that water windows, you know, different elements can play havoc on our thermal cameras, and we've got to make sure that we take that into account, especially if we're looking at quantitative analysis or where we're really looking at getting specific absolute temperatures from things. So right in between the 5.5 to about the 8 band here, the amount of moisture in the window, and you can see at the bottom side of the graph there, it's actually telling you what's causing some of the issues with it. And in this section right here, the atmosphere is actually opaque to most sensors. So we have to work in those specific bands depending on what we're doing. And obviously, it's going to make a difference how far away we are from an object. If we're relatively close to an object, you know, within 200-300 feet, you know, we're good to go with much of this band here. If we're trying to do that same imagery at a third of a mile or a half mile or a mile, obviously we're going to have to count a little bit more because we're going to have to look through more of those particles and molecules in the atmosphere that can cause havoc on our thermal imaging. So in general, as objects get hotter, their frequency, their wavelength moves farther to the left here. And we can see that when you take, you know, a piece of metal and throw it in a fire. You know, that metal can sit in there for 5 minutes in a decently hot fire. You can pull it out and it still doesn't look any different. It'll feel different if you go to touch it. It'll look different in a thermal imager. But visually, we really can't see a difference until we really heat it up. And eventually, it's going to start glowing red. It's glowing red because it's actually giving off that red wavelength. It's become so warm that it's now visibly warm to us, and it allows us to see it in that visible wavelength. So when we start talking about emissivity and reflectivity and transmissivity of thermal IR radiation, we've got to account for it. And we have to account for it because different objects will look different, even within the same atmosphere, the same heat at the exact same temperature. So you can see here that we look at emissivity, and I've got three items up here, representatives of three items. So you can see up in the top right-hand corner at 0.98, we have a black shirt. Your average black cotton shirt has about a 0.98 emissivity. And what that means is that it's going to absorb a lot of that IR radiation. And this is something we all know by this point. We've all gone outside on a hot summer day and worn a dark colored shirt, and you feel really, really warm. When you switch over to a light colored shirt, the temperature hasn't changed. Nothing's changed outside, but you still feel cooler. And that's because it doesn't absorb that radiation as well. So you can see the difference there. The white shirt is actually at 0.9 for emissivity. So it's much less efficient at it. And now when we say 0.9, every single object falls within a 0 and a 1. And what the relation is it's a relation or a ratio between that and a perfect, what we call a black body. So it's a perfect absorber of thermal radiation. So again, our black shirt, while it's not perfectly black, it's really hard to get an object that is very, very black, although I know science is doing some wonderful things with pure black bodies now. But so that's at a 0.98. When we get down and we look at a piece of aluminum foil here, we're at 0.03 to 0.07. So a much, much bigger difference. So what's going to happen is that's actually going to reflect more heat than it is going to emit it. And it becomes a really big difference when we go and we try and measure that. So back a long time ago, you know, Chris Hadfield yesterday was talking about electronics, and he was talking about Kirchhoff and some of his laws around electronics. Well, he also did some work around radiation. And basically what he said is that the absorption at a given wavelength is equal to the emissivity, or the emission at that same wavelength. So the general rule in plain English is good absorbers are good emitters, and good reflectors are poor emitters. All right, we know this. We use, you know, metal as a heat sink in our computers and on our engines, because it gives up that radiation, that thermal energy, so easily. So the basic rule, again, highly reflective, low emissivity. And that really comes into play here. So what I've got right here is I took a thermal image of two tin cans. If you must know, the one on your left here, I believe was baked beans. And then we had Progresso soup on the right there. So what I did is I took the paper off of it, the advertisement on there, and I put a small piece of black electrical tape on each one. Now, the black electrical tape allows us to have a black body in the picture, and it readily absorbs and emits the temperature of the object that it's on. So we use it kind of as a check. So what we can see here is each spot that I have here, you can see spot 1, 2, 3, and 4, each spot was an actual radiometric measurement of that can. The can on the left was filled with hot water. I ran hot water for about 5 minutes through the sink and then just filled up the can. The one on the right, I did the same thing with cold water. Ran it for about 5 minutes and then just set it down there. So what we can see from this is, although if you were to look at the can and take a spot measurement at this spot 2 here, it's showing 84.9 degrees. What that's actually showing is the ambient temperature of the room and then my temperature, because I'm actually centered directly in front of this can when I took the picture. Okay. Same thing when we look at spot 4 on the cold one. The cold one is showing 83.5. I guarantee you that the cold water running for 5 minutes is more than 1 degree cooler than the hot water that was running for 5 minutes. But if we were just to look at this thermal image without taking into account things like reflectivity and emissivity, we may think that they're roughly the exact same temperature. What you can actually see on the first can, although the can itself says 84.9, our spot with our electrical tape on there is actually a more true reading, and it says 106.7. So you can see there's really a 20 plus degree temperature difference there, simply because it's reflecting my temperature and the ambient temperature rather than emitting the temperature that it actually is. And it's the same thing on the cold side. We've got the ambient temperature for spot 4, but if we look, the actual temperature is closer to 63 degrees. So again, we've got almost a 20 degree difference there, just because of the reflectivity and the properties of the material that it's in. And this is called its apparent temperature. So what it's showing right here on the can is the apparent temperature without accounting for its emissive value. There we go. All right, so a lot of objects don't allow transmission. So being able to see things behind certain objects, being able to see the radio signature or the emissivity from an object that's behind another object is very, very difficult. So for instance, if I took a thermal camera and I tried to, you know, we've all seen movies where the military's out there and they're looking through people's walls with thermal cameras to count the number of bad guys or figure out where the hostages are. And I'm not discounting that the military has some really cool technology that we don't have on the civilian side yet. But the reality is thermal does not work that way. While we can see a little bit through walls, as Ben Cruz was talking about with radar, with thermal, it just does not work that way. Now, what we could do is if somebody was touching a specific piece of wall, we could see some of that heat through that. So for instance, I can walk over to the wall and I can lay my hand against it for a second or two, walk away, turn around, and take a picture with a thermal camera, and I will see my handprint clearly. I could do the same thing as I walk through the room with just my socks on. But windows, for instance, and when we start talking about driverless vehicles using thermal cameras, windows may play a little bit of havoc with those, and it's something that we have to take into account. So in this picture here, we can see the outline of the can, we can see the outline of the sink very, very clearly. And the reason behind that is because this specific camera actually had a thermal imager and a digital camera that was integrated together. And so what it does is it uses that sensor fusion that Ben was talking about to fuse the two together. So we get really clear, solid outlines of the plug behind here, the sink, everything like that. If I were to turn that off, this is more of a picture that we got here. So what this picture is this is looking down a hallway, and right here you can see the large square object in the middle. That is actually your typical storm door. So it's a glass storm door that you and I can see through just fine. This was taken in the middle of the day. I think it was about 2 p.m. or so. And we really can't see anything beyond it. What we're actually seeing in this picture here, so along the left and right side, the warmer area, those are actually the walls of the hallway. All right, then we have the outline of the door itself. This darker purple, it's a square in the middle, is actually another door that's about 25 feet behind the camera in this instance. And you see a little bit of heat here. And what you're actually seeing there is my arm poking out of a doorway as I take the picture. Because if I would have stood in front of that door, all you would see is the reflection of my radiation, my thermal radiation, which is not what I wanted to demonstrate in the picture. So instead, what I did is I turned on that sensor fusion. And now you can actually see my wife is just outside of that door. She's standing a foot back from the edge of that door, but looking at a thermal camera alone, we'd have no idea that she's actually there. So when we start talking about the bus stops and things like that, they're usually enclosed by a plastic or glass. If we've got our driverless vehicle driving down the road, if somebody could step out of that bus stop very quickly, and it would take a second for that vehicle to realize that there was actually a person there. You know, and those bus stops are usually built relatively close to the road, sometimes almost at the curb. So there's a window there where it'd be very, very difficult for a driverless vehicle relying purely on a thermal camera to pick folks up. Further, when we look at the reflective objects that are around, you can have a person that's standing safely on the sidewalk and is in no way, shape, or form in front of that vehicle. But if there was a right reflective material around, say a sign, a trash can, mailboxes, all kinds of things like that, that would reflect that heat, the vehicle could think that there is a person about to step into the road based on that. And again, that becomes a reason why that sensor fusion, by using all these different sensors together and really accentuating the pros and minimizing the cons, is very important to get where we need to be when it comes to the driverless vehicles. So if we can't see through windows, how do the lenses on our cameras work, on our thermal cameras work? And the reality is we use a couple of special materials. So we use calcium fluoride and germanium are the two most common lenses. And they've got a nice fun feature that although they are visually opaque to us, we can't see through them at all. And in fact, when you look at them, they look like a nice little mirror. The thermal radiation can go right through it. If you've set up a home security camera at your home, and you've got a camera with an IR light on it, that IR light will never illuminate your outside from the inside looking through a window. That's why you actually have to mount them outside in order to use them, because otherwise you're just going to get a glare back from that IR light. So there's little things we got to take into account when it comes to that. But our germanium and our calcium fluoride allow us to make what we call IR windows. So in very high heat applications, big industrial furnaces, things like that, large electrical panels, when we're trying to look at the temperature within that, they actually make these panels with IR windows, and they make them out of this calcium fluoride or the germanium. That makes these windows very expensive, so it's not something we're going to be putting on all our bus stops or anything like that. It's just something that we need to make sure that we take into account. So if you look to the left here, this is your typical IR image right here. It's really grayscale, kind of the black. The problem is that when we go to pick out details on stuff like this, it's very hard for our brain to do. Computers can do it just fine because they've got the ability to actually, you know, dig deep and look at the actual number associated with each individual pixel. And we can't pick that out with our eyes. So we use color palettes to colorize these objects. So that way we can actually take a look at it and visually interpret data without having to look at just columns of numbers. So you can see on the right-hand side there, we just applied a color palette to this, and now it becomes very, very easy to determine hot from cold. If you look back into your left, you can see on the wall over there in that thermal image, and that's a thermal mosaic that was actually taken in one of the local cities up here by Northland College. So you're looking at houses and businesses and the thermal signature that's radiating off of that. We were able to actually fly that with the UAS and provide that information back to residents in the city, and they were able to then determine whether or not they wanted to make changes to save money. So in the area that we're at, we've got some very old housing, and one of the first things to go is slumping insulation, or maybe not enough insulation in the first place. So you can make some very big changes that'll really save you a lot of money. And I'll give you, for instance, when I moved into my house, the bones of it are from 1910. There's been some additions over the years. But when I moved in there on electric heat, my first January, it cost me $700 for my heat bill. And I thought to myself, boy, what did I just get myself into? With $200 worth of insulation, I was able to cut that bill in half. So it was being able to take these thermal images and use them for inspection, especially as we start talking about sustainability, lowering our carbon footprints. Thermal imaging does a lot for us, and autonomous technologies really helps us with that as well. So we use this in much more than just autonomous vehicles, as far as the driverless cars, using it for crop scouting, and I'll go through all the applications here at the end, but it can be very advantageous to us. So let's talk about some of the applications, and first we'll talk about them in the ADAS, because we got a lot of ADAS here in this. So we can see two different pictures here, nighttime city scene, and if you look here, I mean, we've all been driving at night, where you get glare from lights. It becomes really hard to see things behind the glare. Maybe we get vehicles that are coming towards us, and it kind of blinds us for a second. I'm in a rural area. People sometimes forget that their high beams are on, and they, you know, will drive right past you with them. And we start talking deer on the road and things like that. It becomes very, very hard to pick things like that out when I've got somebody with a high beam coming at me. So you can see on the right here that this is a thermal image of that exact same scene. And then it's also got an algorithm applied by the computer that actually picks out these individual objects. So what we're seeing right here is there's actually people in the road right here. It makes it really hard to make out. I mean, it looks like it could be in reflection from parked cars like it is back here. But these are people in the road, and they're easily distinguished right here with the computer algorithms and the thermal imaging. So again, as we talk about safety and using the strengths of each of these technologies, low light and no light conditions are really a place where thermal and LiDAR and radar shines. So we got a couple of things at the bottom here. According to FLIR, thermal cameras are able to reliably identify humans from up to 200 meters away, which is 4 times farther than your typical headlights even illuminate in rural conditions. Unless you got those fancy, really bright headlights that makes all your neighbors hate you. So here's another situation. You're driving on the highway. You can see that it's a not lit highway. So we're out in kind of a rural area. But the glare from these vehicles, and further the glare from the vehicles that are coming in the opposite direction, really impede your night vision. So if we take that same image, the thermal camera, you know, it's a slightly different image because this car you can see is moving over to this lane and he's already done it in this side. But we can more distinctly pick out those vehicles. We can see those vehicles that are covered by this blinding glare over here very, very clearly. So again, as we start talking about those adaptive cruise control systems and the other safety systems within ADAS equipped vehicles, thermal plays a really big part in the safety of the vehicle and the occupants. Another example, we've all been driving down the road with the sun glare in the morning. I drive east every morning and west every afternoon to get to and from work. And so being able to see within that glare can absolutely be an issue. Chris, did you have a question there?
Yeah, on the thermal imaging systems, can that, and I think I know the answer to this, but I'm not sure. Can thermal be overlaid or be used as a validation to other systems? So if I see something with a camera and I don't quite know what it is, or maybe the computer is only 75% sure, can thermal then increase that maybe validation from 75% to a higher percent? Can the two systems be overlaid?
Absolutely. So if you didn't hear, Chris was wondering if other system information can be overlaid on thermal in order to get a more accurate representation of what's there. So for instance, the instance that he gave is you've got a typical camera that says, hey, there's a 75% chance there's an object in front of you. Can we then overlay that data on thermal to be sure? And absolutely we can, especially when we're talking about, you know, people on the roads, things like that, things that that emit really, really well. It can be used to check the other way as well. When we start talking about the reflectivity of certain materials, if we are reflecting heat into the road in the form of a human, we can use our regular digital cameras as a check on that as well.
Hey, Zach, can you try mute quick and then unmute?
How's that?
Keep talking.
All right, I'll go back to the slideshow here. So again, as we are working within the constraints of our environment, whether it's our sunrise or sunset, being able to mitigate any glare that would cause us not to be able to see. Again, I don't know about you, but I've definitely had instances where I've had to really slow down because I can't see far enough in front of me to safely drive at the speed I was at. And that's even going the speed limit, not, you know, taking into account speeding or anything like that. Again, these two pictures were taken in the exact same environment. We were standing right behind a car, and with the thermal image, it is very, very clear. With the digital camera, with no exterior lighting really available, we don't see it at all. So this is, again, a very good tool for being able to see in low light conditions, no light conditions. Thermal, because of its nature, with that radiation, we actually don't need any light whatsoever. So we could be in a dark cave with no extra light and still be able to see it. Whereas your night vision type things, they're actually amplifying ambient light to provide you a better picture. Same thing with your low light cameras. They amplify a little bit of that ambient light, but it still won't quite do the job in all situations. Especially again, being rural out here where we are, it becomes even more important. We don't have a lot of street lights out here, and we have tons of deer. So it was very, very expensive. All right. Is anybody else having trouble hearing me?
So you're kind of choppy. You're not as bad as other people were. So I'm just trying to have you mute and unmute, see if that fixes it. Try to turn amplify on and then off, see if that fixes it. But without having you have to completely leave and come back.
Well, my choppy or just hard to hear? Because I can maybe try and talk louder.
It's choppy, kind of like staticky almost.
Yeah, you're choppy. I can hear it.
Okay. All right, how am I doing now?
Still kind of sounds choppy. Choppy.
Still choppy. Do you want me to pop back in and out?
Am I all choppy? That would eliminate if it's a bandwidth. Good to me. Is John still John here, or no? Here or no?
See his avatar there.
You're not choppy, but
yep, I'm in here.
Blado, you're not choppy, but Nicklin, you are.
So
pretty clear.
I'm on 2D. Zach and John are on the goggles. So it's either going to be a Wi-Fi or a goggle thing.
Why are John just fine? He doesn't chop at all.
Yeah, I'm on 2D right now.
So it's up to you if you want to leave and come back. I mean, you're almost done. It's 11:47 right now. I mean, it's not terrible, but it's not like crystal clear either.
Well, I'll ask you folks then, throw up some clapping if you want me to continue, if you can hear me enough, and maybe a heart, and I'll pop out and back in. All right, we're about even, so I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to pop out and back in just so we can hear you all the way. So give me 1 second, please, and I apologize for the delay. All right, how much time to know?
It's good.
Sounds good. All right.
Better, Zach.
Perfect. Let me just grab my laser pointer again here quick. There we go. All right, so another way that we're using these autonomous technologies is, as I alluded to a little bit before, we're actually being able to do building envelope inspection. Even just a simple scan from the outside, now we can get more in depth and you can do inside stuff and you can use blower doors to really enhance inspection. But especially in colder environments, it makes it very easy to see where we're leaking heat. However, what we need to keep in mind is there does need to be some interpretation here. And when it comes to fully autonomous systems that are using thermal cameras, this is a prime example. If we were to look at this, we'd say that, wow, this house is really losing a lot of heat here. And we can see that, and especially along the top of the garage here. The reality is again, those are windows. So you're looking at a reflection. You're not looking at any actual heat loss from the building. So interpretation and programming our computers to interpret them correctly becomes a very, very big deal. Where we're actually losing heat is at the bottom of the garage. They make those nice little rubber stoppers that sit on the ground, and these folks don't have one installed. It's actually a brand new building, so they've got a heated garage, and they don't have that rubber stopper along the bottom, so they're actually losing quite a bit of heat out of there. So as we go around this building, we look around the yard, things like that, we can determine where they maybe need to invest a little bit to be able to lower that carbon footprint, which, you know, at the end of the day, lowers their bills. And really, that's what a lot of homeowners, a selling point for homeowners is being able to lower their bills. It's just a happy coincidence that we also help the environment by not wasting extra electricity, wasting extra heat. So bridge inspections, I know, I believe the Idaho Department of Transportation has actually switched from using their big, I think they call them swing trucks, but basically it's like a bucket truck that goes down below the bridge and allows them to do inspections, visual inspections of the underside of bridges. They've actually really reduced their fleet and increased their fleet of drones equipped with thermal cameras. They found that they can find the laminations in bridges a whole lot easier and quicker before they can visually identify them by using a drone with a thermal condition or with a thermal camera under the correct conditions. So when we start talking about road safety, these become a really big deal. I don't know how many, I think most of the folks here are probably not from our area here in Minnesota, but what was it, about 10, 12 years ago, something like that, Chris, maybe you know, but we actually had a bridge collapse in Minneapolis there, the 35W bridge as it goes to Minneapolis. Doing proper inspections and timely inspections using the best equipment that we can use can really help us and save lives. There was plenty of folks who actually died in that incident. Cars that, fell down into the river, things like that, that really could have been avoided if we use the technology that we have available and we use it in the correct way. And you can see here, and this is actually after a one on the right here is actually after a computer algorithm has been applied. Here's the actual image, but we can actually go through and you can see right here, these dark spots, there's delamination there. And we know there's delamination there because those spots are holding water. And you can't visually see that water at all. But once we talk about the different properties of water versus concrete and how water holds heat as the sun goes down or it's colder as the sun comes up, we're able to do that comparative analysis and determine that, hey, there's water sitting underneath the roadway on this bridge that shouldn't be there. And the only way it can sit there is if there's some kind of void that we need to look at and determine whether or not it needs to be fixed and how critical it is. Law enforcement and search and rescue, another huge thing, everything from Alzheimer's patients going missing to little children going missing. Last year, I believe it was out in St. Cloud, Minnesota, a 7-year-old boy had gotten lost. People were out searching for him for hours. It wasn't until a search and rescue organization that had a thermal equipped drone was able to come out and they were able to find the boy perfectly safe. The other side of that is by not using this technology, we've seen a lot of instances where there's almost no reason that someone shouldn't have been found, but they weren't because we weren't able to use the technology for one reason or another. Law enforcement as well, as they're going after suspects, out in the woods, out in cornfields, being able to pinpoint where they are and safely apprehend them. This absolutely plays a huge part. As you get out into wilderness areas, mountains, folks that like hiking, there's been multiple incidences where people have gotten lost, where they've gotten hurt and not been able to go for help. And without a thermal equipped aircraft, people have walked right by these people. If they're unconscious, not able to call out. There's been instances where searchers have actually walked within 10 feet of a missing person and did not see them because of the environment they were in, whether it was the brush or the landscape or whatever it was. And then a thermal equipped drone came back over later and found them relatively quickly. So we can use these as life-saving, not just preventing issues with our advanced vehicles, but actually saving lives in quite a few situations. And it seems like every other week you hear about a new situation where, a small kid was lost or, an autistic kid or somebody with Alzheimer's or dementia that had gotten away from the facility that they were living in.
I have a question, or should I wait?
I heard a question. I can't see the voice moving. Oh, sorry. All right.
Should I wait?
Yes.
Or should I ask?
No, absolutely.
So somebody mentioned that they saw drone footage that was using IR camera, and they said they could see snakes in there. And I thought that was odd because snakes are ectotherms. But then I was thinking, well, they do regulate body temperature by behavior. Have you heard about anyone using these to see snakes?
Absolutely. So I have heard about some people using it for reptiles, and there's quite a few constraints when we start talking reptiles instead of warm-blooded mammals. The big thing is that thermal transition. So they may have been sunning out on a rock all day, and then it turns nighttime, and there's just a little bit of time there where there's some lag, basically. The problem is things become more difficult during what we call thermal crossover. During thermal crossover, which is typically dusk and dawn, and about 30 minutes prior and after, it becomes a little difficult for thermal cameras to see because the ambient air temperature and the ground temperature could be very, very similar. So you need a marked difference in order to see that. If we start talking about activity and movement to warm themselves up, so for instance, we had a snake that was just hanging out. It's nighttime, they're up for whatever reason, they start moving after prey and moving quickly, there's a possibility that they would become slightly warmer than the environment. The issue that you find there is they're typically small unless we're talking about much larger, you know, pythons or constrictors, things like that. If you're looking at garter snakes and even maybe rattlesnakes that, frankly, while they may be 5 feet long, are not really that big around, it may be a lot harder to pick them out. So you've got to basically have about perfect conditions, and you have to make sure that snake spend a lot of time on a hot rock during the day. So it's possible, it's just very difficult.
Yeah. Do I have to put my hand down? How does this work?
Nope, it actually goes down all by itself. It just sits up there for just a moment or so.
Thanks.
Yeah. All right. Solar panel inspections. So again, there's a really big push here in Minnesota, but also other places, to find alternate energy sources. And we all know that the sun is a very large powerhouse when it comes to the amount of energy that it can actually supply, and it does actually supply the earth. So we're finding those ways to harness the energy, but in order to do that, we need to be as efficient as possible. I think anybody who's looked into solar these days, well, it's absolutely can be a savings, and it's absolutely better for the environment. We're not quite as efficient as we'd like to be. There's always, you know, people driving to become more efficient. And one of the things that we stay efficient, and even as efficient as we are, is by doing routine maintenance and inspections. So drone-equipped thermal cameras have actually been a very large growing industry for going out and imaging these solar farms and finding issues with the cell. And it's actually kind of not intuitive in that, you know, you've got these large panels and they're sitting in the sun at the time of the imaging. And so you'd think that they'd be very, very warm. But the way those photovoltaic cells work is they actually wind up slightly cool. The only time that you'll really see a warm spot on those solar panels is when there's some type of issue with the panel. And so having somebody go and fly overhead at a relatively high altitude, we can cover very, very large solar farms in a very small amount of time. They can also be mapped and geographically referenced, so you can tell a technician, you know, you can give them coordinates exactly to where an issue may be that needs to be inspected. So in this case right here, you can see inside the circle, we've got that little hotspot there. That hotspot is something that a technician needs to go and check out. Maybe there's an issue with the panel itself. Maybe it was wired wrong. There's a lot of reasons that it could have issues. Maybe it's hail damage, maybe it was a bird strike. Either way, in order to really use this technology, the solar panels, and to be as efficient as possible, that would need to be investigated. But to have a person walk through, even with a thermal imager handheld, walking through a 20 megawatt solar farm, would take them almost the entire day. Whereas an hour, and you can map out that entire farm with something like an unmanned aircraft or drone. All right, optical gas inspection. So I touched on this a little bit earlier. So using a cooled camera, we've all fueled our car on a really hot day, right? And if you step away from the pump a little bit, you can see those fumes kind of rising out of the car and then falling towards the ground if you're at just the right angle. When we talk industrial applications, there's industrial gases that are out there as they make their way through their processing plant. A small leak can not only be very bad for the environment and the animals around, any people that are around, especially when some of these gases are heavier than air and they build up in lower spaces. So using a cooled imager that works in that mid-wave IR range, we're actually able to see escaping gas. So right here, it's really, really hard to see, but I've actually got a video here that will show you. And it also shows you the difference of the different color palettes that are available and how they play a part in how easy it is to see something. So this one that I'm going to show you is about a 4 pounds per day leak. So really, when we talk about a gas, 4 pounds a day, it doesn't seem like very much, but it definitely adds up here. That is not the right one. Hold on. There we go. So there it is in the typical white hot that we see there. and then it moves into lava, and it's still really hard to see, but if you concentrate kind of right over here as we move to the next one, there's our gas leak. All right, so it was almost impossible to see in some of those other color palettes, but this is just supposed to show that those different color palettes, again, they're there for us to visually see some of these things that we would not otherwise see. Well, that's a little crazy. So color palettes play a really big part there. And then the last one is kind of the easy reach when we start talking thermal. You know, Jill and some of you folks in California and Colorado, even if up in Canada there, are probably familiar with is these wildfires. Going through and being able to not only find the fires, but really keep track of them. Using a drone or an unmanned system up in the air with a thermal imager really allows us to see the breadth and scope of the fire. So if we think back 7-8 years ago or so, you may have seen it in the news, but there was a bunch of firefighters down in Arizona, and I believe it was 19 of them. And during the course of fighting a fire, basically what happened is they got surrounded by fire, and there was no way for them really to get out, and they all died at the time. Having a thermal imager overhead would have really played a huge difference. We'd have been able to see where the fire was going, where it was moving, that it was going around them, and give the people on the ground a heads up. So having these drones overhead and the communication pathway established between the folks watching the feed and the folks actually out in the field can make a really big difference. And so my next video here, it's a very short video, but it was actually taken right outside of my house. This is right across the street from my house. And this is the middle of the day. And a neighbor decided that they wanted to burn some hay or some leaves in a very windy day, and it really got out of hand. So it wound up actually covering probably about 5 or 6 acres there. I'll try and get back up. Now during the middle of the day, you couldn't really see most of this. You could see a few of the very large flames that were building that were burning on some of the very large logs, but actually seeing the stuff as it moved through the grass, actually being able to tell the difference between the stuff that had already burned and is just smoking a bit versus the stuff that is actually on fire was very, very difficult with just doing it visually. So I was lucky enough, I had one of the aircraft at my house because I was doing some testing. And as the fire department pulled up, I asked them if they wanted some thermal imaging, and I was able to put the aircraft up in the air, and then they were able to concentrate their people where they needed to be, and it made a large difference. And there's quite a few fire departments out there that are using this type of technology, whether it's a thermal imager on a drone or on a manned aircraft. They're really seeing a huge change in maybe the way that they approach some of these fires, because we can really see exactly where they are, where they're warmest, where we should focus our resources and attention, and really hopefully stop some of this burning. Now, if we could prevent some of it, then we're really getting somewhere. But stopping it once it starts is still quite the battle, and we need to be prepared to do that. And this is another tool in our tool bag to do that. The beauty of using the drone is that the individual small units of firefighters, especially as we get out into wilderness firefighting, where it's small teams that are out there for, you know, maybe days or weeks at a time, they can get real-time data of the area that they're in and be able to concentrate their resources there. Those folks have much more limited resources because a lot of times they have to pack in whatever they're going to use. So if they can't carry it in, they don't have access to it. And this gives them a lightweight tool in their tool bag that can give exponential help to them on the ground. And I think that is, one last one, animal husbandry. So this is a relatively new topic, and not just animals, people now too. We're really looking at thermal imaging to look at health of animals and people. So for instance, right here, we've got a buddy's horse that was nice enough to let me take some images of. But we can take a look at here, and we can see that actually he just got done being ridden not too long ago. And so this data that we actually took this day was baseline data that we were taking. And the idea is that if they think maybe there's a problem with their horse, we can take a look at this baseline data, we can take a new image, and we can compare them. What they found that as you start to get inflamed muscles and some of the pain that we feel, we start to radiate heat differently. And it's even being used in things like breast cancer research. They're now actually doing thermography with thermal cameras because they found that the cancer cells actually radiate that heat in a different way. So there's tons of different ways we're looking to use this. I know folks have been using this with cows. So as they're getting ready to give birth, as they start moving into giving into being in heat and ready to make new cows. not an agriculture guy, so I can't tell you the term off the top of my head. But they're being used to really take these temperatures, because otherwise it's a person that has to go out there and physically take these temperatures. And I don't know if you've seen a temperature taken of a cow before, but it's quite the invasive process for the cow especially. And then when you start adding in the fact that a lot of these herds in some of these places like Texas and Florida, where you've got, you know, 10, 20, 30, 50,000 acres, you know, knowing where your herd is, knowing that they're safe, being able to count how many animals that you have, it's all very important, and it's all very labor intensive. They spend all day out there, you know, driving along a ranch, trying to count the cattle, trying to estimate. Maybe they pay a plane to fly overhead and somebody takes some pictures and they pull it out and they start counting by hand. Being able to use thermal imaging, we could do it, day or night, doesn't matter if nighttime is the only time we have. Not only can we go out there and we get temperature data from the animals themselves, but we can start seeing some of their medical issues before it becomes very, very plain. So they're finding new ways to use these imagers all the time. And it's just an exciting kind of field to be in. Yes. I think you're on mute still.
All right. Yeah, I remember seeing thermal imaging of the Porter Ranch gas seep, and the methane that was coming out was, I guess, cooler than the atmosphere. And it was really, I mean, it was black, you know, compared to the you could see it. And so I'm wondering, would the same imager be able to identify smaller gas seeps like a La Brea tar pit, or, you know, just methane seeps from wetlands?
Yeah, absolutely. It would partially depend on volume, and it would partially depend on budget. So as we start talking about these actively cooled midwave IR type systems, they get very expensive very quick. And I'll give you an example. The handheld imager that I used for this picture right here was slightly more than your cheaper stuff that you can get from like Home Depot and stuff like that. It cost about $700, and it's really great. You know, plus or minus about 3 degrees Celsius. If you look at the drone-based stuff that I used for these images over on the side wall there. That's a radiometric sensor. It retailed at about $13,000, I think, at the time we bought it. Those cooled systems that are used for optical gas inspection, because they must be actively cooled, they're a lot more expensive. So there you're looking at hundreds of thousands of dollars for a lot of those systems. And we can just keep going up from there.
I was just looking at the FLIR, the View Pro R radiometric. And it's mm-hmm. retailing for under $4,000 for a drone.
They are now. We pulled ours. We have the XTR, and it also depends on the resolution. I don't know if the Pro R there, you can buy it in multiple resolutions, I believe. But the 640 by 512 is kind of the minimum that you want. And when we bought ours, I believe it was about 4 or 5 years ago now, that was retailing at almost $13,000. The prices have gone down quite a bit over the years here as we get better at the technology, as it's more integrated and used. But the reality is that, again, some of these sensors, especially if you're looking at small seeps over wide areas, it's going to have to be a cooled camera, which the ProView is not. And it is going to be significantly more expensive than the XTR that I'm using, or the View Pro that you're talking about.
So the cold camera, would that be able to see a significant seep like Porter Ranch? Or is a cold camera different from the ones you're talking about?
So I don't know about Porter Ranch specifically, but I can tell you that in that last video, or not the last video, but the previous video here, you know, this was about $100,000 camera that was used to capture this. And it's about, like I said, about 4 pounds a day leak. And even then, depending on conditions, it's really hard to image just simply because of its nature. Now, there are, you know, other more expensive cameras out there. There are multi-million dollar thermal camera systems that are used in manned aircraft. But thermal is definitely one of those fields where you get what you pay for. And be able to see, again, smaller leaks over larger areas, you're going to want a fairly accurate camera. And to get more accuracy, it's got to be cool. All right. Any other questions? Thank you. All right. Well, if you have any other questions, you can always get a hold of me. Our contact information is out there on all the slideshows. The slideshows are going to be on our website. We will be sending out an email, not only with that survey, but we'll have a link to our website where all the materials are going to be, along with the presentations and some of the videos that you saw. There's probably going to be some other videos out there. We've also got some links to curriculum that we found on some of these topics. Some of them are geared towards middle school, some of them are geared towards college, and just kind of a mix based on the stuff that we found to make it easier to integrate the stuff into the classroom. As far as my slides go, more than happy, you're more than welcome to use them in whatever way you see fit, you know, in your classroom. And then let's see, when it comes to STEM camps and things like that, I know some folks had some questions regarding STEM camps and some of the things that we're doing out there. And I can tell you, each portion of NCAT, you know, we've got Trans COE, they've got their NitroLex car competition that they do all over the state of Minnesota, and I believe maybe even outside of it. We've got Jill Zandi with MATE. She's got the MATE ROV competition, and that's a worldwide competition. I mean, China all the way around back here to California, and her and her team have done a great job with that. There's multiple different levels, everything from younger kids all the way up and into, you know, four-year college and universities. We've got the virtual RAD competition and the RAD competition that we do around drones. We are all looking to put together a competition that involves all of us. We do educator workshops like we're doing right now. The Geotech Center was nice enough to let us do one for them. But we also do stuff around drones specifically, whether it's building or integrating into the classroom. Again, on our website there on the NCATtech.org, you'll see some of the videos and clips, you know, clips and full videos of some of the other things that we've done around workshops, whether it's integration for students, summer camps. We had a Bring Your Drones to School, where it was all about the different considerations of using drones in a school environment, and everything kind of teachers need to know from part 107 all the way around to how to convince your administrator that it's a good idea. So lots of resources out there on the NCAT Tech website. Please bookmark it. That we're constantly going to be adding stuff there, and it's all going to be around AT. We put out announcements. We've got a newsletter you can sign up for there that tells you what's going on with our different parts of NCAT. As if you don't know NCAT, we're really focused in three parts of autonomous technology. That's the maritime systems, the driverless and advanced automated vehicles, and then the unmanned aircraft. So we do as much as we can around that. We try and spread the word. We're on Facebook. I believe we're on Twitter. I'm not a Twitter guy, but Zach, are we on Twitter?
That is a good question. I do not know.
Well, our marketing person's not here today because she's in another conference. But we are on social media, so you can find us out there, NCAT, National Center for Autonomous Technologies. And then outside of that, if you ever have any questions, I know our team here, Chris Hadfield, Jill Zandi, Ben Cruz, Kirk Stuvey, and myself, we love to answer questions and we love to talk to educators. So please reach out. We happily share stuff. I know Ben Cruz also has some summer camps and workshops for educators as well around the automotive side. There's tons of stuff available, and we're here to share. We're here to get the word out. We want to see you adapt this technology and adopt it into your classroom, because frankly, we need that education. We need to educate the workforce of the future, because the way things stand now, unless we really step things up, we're going to find a significant gap, and that's going to hurt us in the end. So we want those students to go out, get those high-paying careers, and that all starts with us bringing this stuff into the classroom. So thank you very much for your time. Please look for that email for the survey. Please give us all the feedback you have, positive or negative. We're pretty thick-skinned here. We want to learn. We want to do better. There's always room for improvement, and we need you to tell us where that is. So, thank you very much, and you folks have a great day.
Thanks, Zach.